Finally, tonight to Syria. More than 100,000 people have died in the two-year civil war, according to the United Nations, and the conflict has caused misery beyond the country's borders. More than a million people have fled the fighting, many of them to Jordan and the world's second-largest refugee camp, known as Zaatari. Lindsey Hilsum of Independent Television News spent 24 hours there reporting firsthand on the human cost of war.
It's Ramadan, and dusk is falling over the biggest refugee camp in the Middle East. A year ago, this was a dusty patch of desert. Today, it's home to 120,000 people. I'm with Killian Kleinschmidt, the man who's trying to turn chaos into order.
Well, you're seeing here this cable, which is pulled by somebody who has been selling it to the people in this area, because they technically don't have electricity.
The camp has grown more quickly than the UN's capacity to connect all the tents and trailers. They have no idea what the bill's going to be. So now he's put in a new transformer and got the bootleg engineers to protect it. The guys who were doing all these things illegally, you're getting them on your side?
We're getting them on the side because we're not saying stop it. We're saying let's work together and improving it.
Bright lights, almost big city.
They call this the Champs-Élysées. The goods on sale might be a bit different, but the point is that this is a street in what increasingly looks like a town. In the last couple of months, Zaatari has taken on an air of permanence. The Syrians here might not want to admit it, but they know. They're not going back tomorrow or next week. Not next year either.
Because in the winter, this will all get muddy and full with...
Yeah, horrible. Yeah.
Walking around, we came across a group of 16-year-old girls. They told me they hated life in Zaatari, but had no hope of going home to Deraa in Syria.
What can we do? Assad is still going strong.
The boys, like boys everywhere, were playing shoot 'em up computer games. But for them, violence isn't abstract. In fact, they see this as practice.
These kids were bombed and saw battles and destruction, so ideas began to develop in their minds. They started dreaming of becoming part of the resistance, of fighting and defending their country.
Friday, Saturday, I'm in Amman usually.
Killian is talking to the elders. Now it's dark, they've broken the Ramadan fast.
Yeah, but I would like to do more, and we can do more. But we need to work together more.
They complain to him about water pollution. Although on occasion, refugees have smuggled out mud-covered stolen tents inside the tankers. It's not always easy to build trust. Early morning, and the bread van arrives. Bread's distributed for free, but now bakeries are springing up in the camp. It's usually the children's job to collect the family supply. There are 60,000 kids in the camp. Only a quarter of them go to school. They roam around, chucking stones.
When you want to be happy, what do you do?
A project to help children reconnect with their emotions. War and exile have robbed them of all sense of risk for themselves or anyone else.
These children have lived for a particularly long time in levels of stress that are incredibly profound. So when that happens, there's a part of your brain that goes, you've experienced too much. And it's like a SIM card in a phone, it turns itself off, you go into survivor mode.
As if to prove the point, one lobbed a stone at the aid worker's vehicle as they left. Water is a scarce resource in the camp, but the kids aren't worried. Dusk is falling again. For the children, the years stretch ahead in a camp that became a town in the desert in Jordan. Soon Syria will be just a dream.